Good morning, everybody. Look at this beautiful day today. It's unbelievable. It is the 4th day of June. Unbelievable day. And this is the time of year, I must say, the time of the garden, that my brain and my consciousness goes into a whole other place. The work is so steady. And I move from place to place. It's sort of I lose complete touch with time. Every once in a while, I am brought to my senses about time, and I stand up and I look around and I think, yada, 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 it's another day passing. But my Lord, what I get into here, and it is the ultimate joy for me of doing this work. I thought today I would just show you around the garden before we get into a few very specific things I wanted to show you how to do, a couple of tricks, a couple of tips, a couple of whatevers. You may already know them, so they won't be new to you, but maybe, maybe to some folks they'll be new. And let's have a look around and see what's cooking, both in the vegetable garden and in the perennial garden, which is the other half. I wanted you to see the perennial garden and a little bit of how I designed it. This beautiful wolf-eye dogwood is right in the center in its own circular bed. And then the garden was designed to sort of twist and turn, because I love the idea of meandering, and in this case it sort of takes us right into the tulip, the lilacs, which I love, and you simply can't avoid them, and that's the whole point of the design. This is like heaven, man. This is exactly what I wanted. It's taken about 4 years for these lilacs to finally do what they're doing, and I'm crazy about it. All right, I'll show you the rest of the garden as we go around the corner here. See how compressed this space is? I love that, because right behind me is the opening. And this is a Frank Lloyd Wright sort of structure, where you compress the space before you open it up. And ultimately, I'm going to be creating a water element in the center there. So it's a perfect place to come to. Now we're on this side of the lilacs. And this is what I call my purple garden here. All sorts of beautiful flowers with dark purple to lilac purple stems. And this is called meadow rue or thalictrum. And in the evening, these are beautifully backlit. Oh my goodness, how beautiful. And I've got the clematis growing on the trellises. They look fairly tame. They're not always so easy to control. And this bed that we're walking past here is sort of in development again. I've dug up a lot of stuff, but there's also a lot here that I like. And we'll watch it over the course of the summer, and you'll see it'll develop. And I think the same with several beds that have been emptied out. But they'll come back. I got time to plant those. And in this trellis, I've got two kinds of clematis coming up. There are two different kinds. This is a dark purple, beautiful flower. And this side here, this is like a dark, dark red. And I just put these old trellises I had here against the opening portico here. So this is the garden, and there's more up here at the top in the sun, and that will get developed over time, and I will show you that as we go along. Okay, so we're going to leave this garden, and this grass walkways separate these long row of blueberry bushes, and you can see that they extend all the way down to the other side of the garden. So we get plenty of blueberries. Here we have a mix of perennials and annuals that I've planted. This is going to be an extremely colorful bed. And these here are known as pinky winky hydrangea, and they're gorgeous. I've cut them back considerably from what they were, but boy, oh boy, they're going to be something. And now, it's kind of coming through this, by the way. This is a fun thing. I've been growing for several years now. This is hops. And I often give away the hops to folks I know who make beer, and I can usually get several pounds out of this. This will go all the way up and over, or part of the way over. And if you can see on the other side, I have sweet pea, which very aggressively will climb this side of the trellis, and they will intermingle at the top. And just a little update, that little lettuce bed that we started, you saw when it was just the plants were an inch or two high. We've already had a couple of cuttings. Here's the head lettuce that I separated and we transplanted last time, and I'll show you those in a minute. The garlic, as you can see, is killer. And my dear friend Maddie, who works with me in this garden, is a garlic grower. And even he says that these are going to be pretty great. These guys are going to start putting off what they call scapes, which are the seed pods. Not quite yet, and I'll show you when we get there, probably in 10 days or so. Here are some of the red lettuce transplants we did 2 weeks ago. They were little tiny guys, remember? And now they're coming into fruition. More garlic. I planted some of those. Remember I told you that I like to sneak lettuce plants in among places where they will not be competed with. Lettuce, when it gets hot, and it's been getting hot, tends to like some of the coolness of shade. So they're doing beautifully in the lilacs. Did I say lilacs? I don't mean lilacs, garlic. Two very different smells, as you will notice. Anyway, up here you can just see the broccoli is starting again, more lettuce transplants that will come before the garlic, what is it with the garlic? Before the broccoli starts to spread itself out, and those leaves will just go to about 18 inches or so. Snap peas up against that trellis. Ah, man, we still have stuff to plant. Here you can see our next, I already pulled one, spinach crop, our early spinach, and this is the succession. Here are two different kinds of radishes. These are cipollini onions, and look at these lettuce heads. Boy, are they just ready to go. The bibs are headed up, gonna cut a couple probably tomorrow. Here's where we planted some more of the lettuce heads among the fava beans, and they're popping up. The onions are getting along. Everything is just doing great. Look at the peas, by the way. The peas are in blossom, that first row. Remember, the second row was a later crop, and they'll start getting ready as soon as the others are matured and harvested. And here you can see my mix of always putting flowers amongst the vegetables. We've got celery, we've got cauliflower, we've got beets, and we've got more lettuce greens. And we're gonna show you, I'm gonna show you a little trick about planting carrots in a little bit. So there's the garden pretty much. And let's get down to business. So today we're gonna do a little experiment with tomato planting. I've just created, this was a little nook. And as you've already seen by my crazy habits, that I don't like to let, any space go unfilled. And this, I sort of didn't know what to do with this here, and I thought I'd put in four tomatoes. I've made a little quadrant here. I'm stepping all over the ground, so I'll have to dig that up a little bit. But the experiment we're talking about today is with two cherry tomatoes called Sun Gold. And these are fabulous tomatoes. Now most people, when they plant tomatoes, just dig a hole, fill it with compost and other supplements or fertilizer if they're not organic folks, stick it in the hole, cover it up, perhaps stake it, and let it grow. But we're gonna do something different today. I know, hold your breath, because this seems like sacrilege to a tomato, right? Okay, so here's this beautiful start, which is full of beautiful roots already. And what I'm gonna do, hold your breath, is I'm going to snip off all the lower growth, absolutely bare. Oh my God, you're killing me. Actually, I'm not. And I'll tell you something about tomatoes. Tomatoes are what we call adventitious rooters, which means that wherever the stem is in contact with the soil, it will lay down roots. So, hence this first trick today. So instead of burying, actually, I might even take this guy. I'm gonna leave these blossoms just for the heck of it. I'm gonna lay this puppy on its side, and then I'm gonna bring it up, you'll see. Wait a second, where is my, okay. So I'm gonna lay this down on its side. Can you see that? And then I'm gonna cover up the whole stem. And just put a little bit of a pillow of soil on this side to prop up the end of the tomato, I'm gonna want it deeper yet. And I'm gonna come back, by the way, and fertilize this some further. There is already compost and fertilizer in the soil, but I'm gonna lay some more compost on top and actually draw a ring around so I don't wind up at any time stepping on the roots of this plant. Okay, so that's one thing. Now, here's the second. Got another sun gold, and I'm gonna do the very same thing that I did with this. But we're gonna do a very cute little experiment. I hope it's cute. If you know it, don't tell me. Just turn off the show. I'm kidding. Don't turn off the show. Okay, now I'm gonna come over to this hole, and you'll notice that this trench is a little deeper than the other one was. And the reason it is deeper is because I'm about to try an old folklore tip here for fertilizing tomatoes, and that's gonna be the basis of our experiment between these two sun gold plants. The egg, the banana. Now, egg is loaded with calcium. Banana is loaded with phosphorus, potassium, all the minerals that tomatoes love and any fruiting plant will love. I'm gonna sort of slit this. It's kind of rotten tomato. And I'm going to lay them in the planting bed. You see, that's why it's deeper. Put them over to the side. Can you see that? Tomato and the egg. Actually, I want to get them a little deeper because okay. Now I'm going to cover those babies up. Now, I should say about this piece of folklore, there is considerable controversy about it. Namely, somebody said, or somewhere where I've read recently, said that they opened up some pharaoh's tombs or some Chinese emperor's tomb, and they found eggs in the tomb, and the shells of the eggs were not decomposed, and this was a couple thousand years, something like that. I have a feeling that in spite of the fact that they may not crumble all the way down, that they do give off some calcium, and calcium, by the way, is a very helpful mineral for the tomatoes because it prevents, or it tends to prevent, what they call blossom end rot, which is a total pain in the neck if you're growing tomatoes. Anyway, I've got them down there. I'm gonna lay this other sun gold on its side. Gonna pillow it up. There we go. And then lay a little cushion here for it. And when it starts coming up, we're going to be able to tie it right to the stake. And then, by the way, once that starts growing, I'm going to show you a unique way to stake tomatoes. So we're going to see which sun gold plant produces most, and is that a total folklore lie? Well, here we are at the potato tip patch, and you may remember when there was nothing here, and I just put in the seeds, and then I think a couple of weeks ago we saw them pop up an inch or two, and now you can see that these rows are filled out. And I told you then what I'm going to do now, which is hilling the potatoes. Now remember that potatoes are nightshades. They're in the same family as tomatoes. And as I said about tomatoes, potatoes are adventitious rooters as well, which means that wherever their stems are under soil, they'll produce roots. And from those roots will grow the tubers. So theoretically, we're mounding them up with nice soft soil in which the tubers can expand. And here we go. I'm going to take from the middle of the trench between. I'm going to pull up soil high up against the stems. I've been walking a little in those rows, so that's why the soil has gotten a little compacted, but easy to chop up. Now I'm going to go back on this side and push. And the potatoes plants, which were 6 or 8 inches sticking out of the ground, well, they're more than that, actually, have just a little more than their tops sticking out. You know, I would have done this about a week earlier, but where was the camera guy? He wasn't here, was he? So they are a little taller than I would like them to be. However, not a problem. Have plenty of dirt to dig up in the middle of the rows. You all get the picture, right? I'll finish this up a little later. But I want to go around the corner and show you what's going on in our potato cages, okay? So now you'll remember that we planted potatoes in these cages, different varieties, and I told you I would hill them up when they got up to a certain height, and I would say that they're probably about 8 inches tall now. And look at them. I mean, they're just beautiful. So I've got this... I've got this bag of soil and straw mix, and I am just going to lay it down in there. Again, one of the laws or the rules of doing this mixture of straw and soil is that we want to have more soil in the mix than straw. And that's, turns out, is just much more productive for the tomatoes, the potatoes. Okay, now we're ready. I'm going to hill up the third cage. Actually, it's second cage, but the third planting. And this is with that wonderful French fingerling called La Rate. You see how this is sort of more soil heavy than straw? And that's a good deal. The straw, however, will work in some ways as mulch and keep our moisture in. And I'll finish up the rest of these and we'll be on our way. Next time we see these, they're going to be up higher yet, and I will have insulated the top part of the fencing with some more straw so that the potato vines don't grow out. So this year, I'm growing something that I've never grown before, and that's sweet potatoes. And I've always heard that the Northeast does not have long enough a season to get these 90 to 100 day plants growing, so they'll create tubers of sweet potatoes, which we love. So I ordered a package of slips, sweet potato slips, which are essentially stems that are slightly rooted. And I got these four tubs, which I have filled with very rich soil, because sweet potatoes like that quite a bit. And I've put in these supports. I've got four pots, and in this garden is my my second year grape vine vineyard. And I've even got some strawberries in here, which didn't fare all that well over the winter. I'm not sure exactly why, but in any case, we are having fruit. So I planted the slips about 4 or 5 inches deep. The soil was rich, a lot of compost in there, plus potting soil to keep it light, because they like to have light soil so they can expand. And they really did look like dead sticks. But as you can see, and this was just about a week ago, they are starting to put out leaves. Here, here, here. Even this guy that still looks sort of dead is starting to develop leaves. And these supports, which I had lying around the garden, which are beautiful old Italianate garden ornaments, I've stuck in three of the four pots because I only had three of them. And these are old tomato stakes. Not old, but they are tomato stakes designed for the plant to curl around. And that's what we want for sweet potatoes to do, sweet potato vines to do, because they're prolific. And I don't have the space in the regular garden for it, so therefore doing it in pots. As they grow, I will, I don't want to press them too much, but will allow them to grab hold of these and come up, and then they'll spill over like you've seen sweet potato plants in flower pot arrangements. And I've got 1, 2, 3, 4. I keep them nice and watered, and we'll watch the progress of them over the season. And so we come to the end of episode 5 of the Folklore Gardener with your host, Sam Bittman. And I repeat every time at the end of a show that however crazy the world gets, however crazy the world gets, and when it ceases to satisfy, there's always the garden. See you next time.